Around the world, there are many NGOs, many international organizations, working to regulate and distribute humanitarian aid. Most of these organizations use a pyramidal model, management model, where decisions are taken at the very top, and those affected at the bottom are seldom asked if they lack the solutions. Because these organizations are very big, they have a tendency to use heavy bureaucratic systems, and they're also very pragmatic. This organization also tend to get most of international aid and money and attention, while local, small-scale initiatives are left with the scraps, even though their projects are more meaningful, passionate, and innovative. So what is exactly the impact of these small-scale initiatives? In 2010, I started working on a road safety project in Laos with an international organization. A few weeks after I started, I witnessed a terrible accident in the city center that left two victims to die on the side of the road with nobody to rescue them. The need of an ambulance service really hit me at that time, but I was also wondering, why are there so many NGOs in this country and no one to set up a rescue service? I did some research and I found the answer. Nearby Thailand had tried to set up an ambulance service. Two NGOs had tried too, but they all failed. And as long as these big fish have tried and failed, everyone's opinion was that this was an impossible project. A few weeks later, I got to meet a group of volunteers from a local foundation. They just got a strange donation. They got an ambulance. And we wanted to work together because we shared a common passion, the passion to save lives. In any Western country, before starting an ambulance service, you would be pragmatic enough to wait to get for sponsorship, training, equipment, not in Laos. We wanted to start immediately because every day people were left to die on the roadside. So we started actually with, we created Vientiane Rescue 1 week after we met. Vientiane Rescue was the first ever free ambulance service in the history of Laos. An ambulance service with no training, no equipment, no sponsorship, and only one single vehicle to cover a 700,000 inhabitant city. Yeah, you can say it, that was insane. And while we expected to get some interest from possible donors, we actually got scorn and chilly advices such as, do you realize the responsibility on your shoulders? But responsibility for them was a legal aspect. But responsibility for us was a duty. The first 2 years were pretty difficult. And little by little, more and more volunteers were joining the team. We were making progress. That is, until in 2012, when we lost our ambulance. We had to shut our service down for a whole year. At that time, we were using a flat management model, where the managers were elected by the volunteers, working with the volunteers on the field, hand in hand, all together, as a family. We wanted to do things differently. We wanted to do things our way. And we failed, miserably. I started wondering if our failure was due to our management model, or because we didn't have a business plan, or because of our lack of pragmatism. 1 year passed, and we managed to start again by collecting enough money to buy this. Yeah, a pumpkin. After a lot of work, we changed the paint, got some stickers, bought some new engine, emergency lights, and everything that was needed to get, I was near to say a new ambulance, something like this. We were ready to start again, but starting again from scratch once again was, as you can imagine, really tough. These things can take a toll on you, and they did on me. While converting myself to pragmatism, I also became angry and cynical. We turned our flat management model to a more directive, vertical one. I was focusing on sponsorship, training, equipment, sustainability, future, the means, and the results. I was becoming just another manager. I told myself that this was for the sake of the team. Well, I think a larger organization would have been proud of me. And then a few months pass, and one of our volunteers bought two second-hand scuba diving suits to start a scuba diving rescue team. I was a bit surprised, and I was against the idea, but it was the volunteers' money, so. I was against the idea because we didn't have a clue about scuba diving. Who exactly were we supposed to rescue? Dead bodies from the Mekong River? It was a waste of time, it was a waste of money. It was an insane idea, but it was a beautiful idea. A few weeks after we got this scuba diving equipment, a father called us because he lost his son in the Mekong River. The kid was playing with his phone, but he dropped it into the river. He jumped, but he couldn't swim, so he never came back to the surface. Then the father called us. It was completely out of the blue because nobody knew we had a scuba diving rescue team. Anyway, we arrive on the Mekong River and we start diving for 3 hours, but in the end, nothing. When I said we got diving equipment, I'm not talking about the fancy equipment. We got the bottles, the jackets, and the goggles, but no gloves, no flippers. So we were quickly covered in bruises and wounds, some deep. Also, the current was very strong. And we didn't know how to use the equipment properly. So it was dangerous, it was useless, and it was getting dark. Enough good reasons to just give up and go back to the office, and nobody would have blamed us. So I told the team, enough, let's go home. Surprisingly, the volunteers wanted to stay longer. This made me upset. I told them, do you realize that with such a current, the body is gone forever? Do you realize that we all got covers and bruises and wounds? Do you realize that two of us almost got taken by the current? So many risks for what? And what do you want to stay longer for anyway? Even if you recover, the body is dead. Then I got my answer. One of the volunteers told me, we have to stay, because the father of the kid is crying. By becoming so pragmatic, I just lost sight of the real meaning of our service. Vientiane Rescue was not a technical service. We haven't had built this team to offer a faceless, impersonal service to victims and their families. If we had built this team, it was to offer our hand at the most tragic of times. And I understood why the father called us. He called us because we are the people's last resort. And this trust, this confidence is the most beautiful of our achievements. After this this event, you know, I almost became a cold, calculating international consultant, and it was a close call, but that day on the Mekong River, these amazing volunteers reminded me that the most important is to follow your passionate heart and not your practical mind. I stopped being pragmatic today. I truly believe that our passion is the only thing that truly matters. Every time we face new challenges, we only ask ourselves one single question. What is the right thing to do? We do have a vision, sure, but not a vision based on a business plan. Our vision is based on humanity. This story would be just an anecdote if we had failed again in the end. But Vientiane Rescue today, it's 220 volunteers, and our scuba divers, firefighters, paramedics, hydraulic rescue team will have saved, for 2016 alone, 10,000 people. Last year, a TV crew from Al Jazeera came to make a documentary about our work. Right after, we got feedbacks from all around the world, but especially one from Canada. The guy said, before watching your documentary, I had lost faith in humanity, but not anymore thanks to you. I used to believe, like this guy, that our model was unique, but it's not. There are people all around the world fighting an everyday battle to change the world on a local scale. This is true in Burkina Faso, where a small entrepreneur is fighting an unthinkable battle against huge chemical trusts to substitute chemical pesticides with organic pesticides made of natural ingredients. This is true in the US, where food cooperatives are formed and our consumers are part of the decision making. This is true in France, where farmers, local farmers, are selling organic products and working together with local communities outside of the standard distribution circuits. This is true in Benin, where a small cooperative is planting seeds of the legendary baobab tree to fight against desertification. And this is true in India. In India, you have people whose job is to clean latrines bare hands. There's a man in India who fought against this. He took a crowd with him all around the country, and he managed to demolish dry latrines one by one, and he forced the government to give 300,000 jobs to these people to free them from this slavery. This is true all around the world. Firefighters from all around the world need the passion to save lives, to enter buildings on fire. Otherwise, they would just stay outside. Whistleblowers need to be passionate by truth to fight against injustice, corruption, and worldwide surveillance. Otherwise, they would just look away. All these people rejected pragmatism. Many great ideas are thrown or left behind because sometimes one person decided that they were not practical or doable or they were not good ideas. But maybe these people should open their minds to new horizons. The examples I gave to you are coming from different fields and countries, but they all have something in common. So let me give you not a recipe, but let's call it a recipe. First, you need a purpose, and sometimes a high purpose. If we take this example of the small entrepreneur in Burkina Faso, his purpose is to stop arable lands to be destroyed by chemical pesticides. And for this, when I'm talking about huge chemical trusts, you know who I'm talking about. I'm talking about Monsanto. He's fighting against Monsanto. So is he fighting a losing battle? That's for sure, for today. Because if you could look in his eyes, you would see that tomorrow he's going to win this battle. And he's going to win this battle because there is a crowd behind him. And that's the second point. You need a community behind you, a community that you will convert to your passion and to your project. Three, you need your project to be local, a local project for local people done by local people to give local solutions to local issues. Four, young people. If you invest in youth, you will make long-term change. Done. So even if he's almost my height, he's not 18 years old. So, Ton used to come at the office 2 years ago already because he wanted to be part of the team, and we were happy to see him, but not inside the ambulance. But he was continuing to come after school every day and even on weekends because his father is part of the team too. But every time he was trying to get in the ambulance, there was always someone to tell him, come on, you're 18 years old. You can't do it. But one day, an emergency, we get in the ambulance, shut the door, and then he comes to knock at the door. I open the door, I see him, I say, oh, come on. How many times I told you? It's impossible. And he told me, yes, but you forgot the first aid bag. You will find useful people everywhere, but passionate people like this guy. They're so precious. So you need to have them around you. And you cut me. And that's the last point, passion. If Ton is wearing our uniform today, it's because of his passion. And passion can transform people. Passion cannot be taught by pragmatism because pragmatism can kill passion. Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, the writer of The Little Prince, once said, if you want to build a ship, don't start by gathering wood, cutting boards, and distributing orders, but awaken within the heart of man the desire for the vast and endless sea. Small-scale initiatives. This is the ocean view. And this body is a sailor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please.